since we don't have anything at all. Amen. Somebody help me out here. Now I'm a Pentecostal preacher, so I need some help tonight. Somebody give the Lord a shout of praise in the house of the Lord, because there's only Jesus. Amen. We don't have anybody but Jesus. He saved me. Did he save you? Hallelujah. He rescued me from an early grave. How about you? Lord Jesus has done a good thing for me. Hallelujah. He brought me from the kingdom of darkness, and he brought me into the kingdom of light. Somebody's got to say hallelujah tonight. Somebody's got to give the Lord a shout of praise tonight. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad that he saved me, that he raised me up, and that he sent his son to love me. Hallelujah. I'm so glad that Jesus is here. You know, our message tonight is on the very important theme of unity. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3, I'm reading from the New King James Version, says this: endeavoring. Say that word, please. Endeavoring. Now let that get into your spirit. Endeavoring. That means that it's going to take an effort. Christians, too many times we want things to come easy. Amen?
Amen.
See, I'm just going to come out swinging tonight, all right? Because I believe that it's time for the Church of Jesus Christ to get serious. We've been playing spiritual games for too long. We've been playing church for too long. We've been worrying about little things like, oh, her dress, I am wearing the same dress. Well, I have never had that problem, praise God. I don't understand why women do it all upset. If another guy wore a shirt like this, I'd say, hey, cool, man. But we're worrying about little things. And you know what? We fight. And we bicker. And we argue with each other. And we say, you don't go to my church, so I got a problem with you. Come on, somebody. Are we ready to repent tonight and do business under the blood of Jesus Christ? Because the blood of Jesus Christ is what unifies you and I tonight. If I don't got the blood of Jesus, I don't got unity with you no matter how hard we try. Endeavoring. It's not going to be easy sometimes when the Word of God says, I'm going to have to endeavor. Oh, come on. It's hard. Tell your neighbor it's hard. It's hard to walk in unity with someone that you have fundamental theological differences with. Come on. But when you get down to the bottom line, my theological opinion might be a little different than yours, but I'm washed in the blood of Jesus. Somebody praise the name of Jesus. That's what it's all about. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the spirit of the bond of peace. There's too much division in the body of Christ. And I declare tonight, in the name of Jesus Christ, that we are going to bury that division at the foot of the cross, and we're going to let the blood of Jesus draw us together as one. For in Christ Jesus is no Jew nor Greek. In Christ Jesus is no slave nor free. Somebody help me. In Christ Jesus is no male nor female. For we are one new man in Jesus Christ. And that is the body of Christ. That is the body of Christ. And there is no other. There is no First Baptist, First Assembly, First Lutheran, First Pentecostal. There is the church. Filled with the Holy Ghost and fire, and that church This is the hour of your destiny. Why must we sit back in petty squabbles and petty disagreements when a nation is dying and crying for a resurrection? And I serve a God of the resurrection. He is the resurrection. He is the life. You say your church is dead. I call resurrection in Jesus' name. I declare resurrection in Jesus' name. You don't have to keep dying when He is the resurrection and the life.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, somebody give the Lord praise tonight. I'm just going to talk a real simple sermon because I'm a simple guy. There's only two keys to unity. And I'm going to give them to you tonight real quickly. But before I do, I want to declare just how important unity is. You see, I've been in ministry for about 23 years now. And one thing I've learned, because I've got a unique background. There's not many people that have done missions work in the bush of Alaska, fly-in only villages. And then come to northern Minnesota, just outside Fargo, North Dakota. And then God calls me here. That's a long way. I didn't like move next door. But one thing I've seen, whether I'm working with Tlingit Indians, or whether I'm working with Yupik Eskimos, or whether I'm with a bunch of Scandinavians from Minnesota, or whether I'm down here, where I no longer have to shovel snow. Amen? I've seen something. I've found that there is a simple key to unity no matter what culture you're in. Because the body of Christ transcends culture. The body of Christ transcends race. The body of Christ transcends language. And it also transcends generations. They talk about a generation gap. Well, the world can have it. The body of Christ doesn't have it. Yes. Amen? Amen. We bring it into the church from the world. Yes. It's time to kick it out.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
How important is unity then? John 17:21, Jesus in his high priestly prayer, right before the cross, he prayed that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us. Now listen for the reason that the world may believe that you sent me. Unity. How important is our unity? That the world may believe. You see, we got a problem in our generation. The world doesn't believe. The world does not believe that Jesus is the Christ. Jesus prayed for the unity of the believers so the world might know that God sent Jesus to purchase humanity and restore right relationship to God. Listen, the church that is unified is evidence of the truth of Jesus Christ. Evidence of Jesus Christ the way. Evidence of Jesus Christ the truth. Evidence of Jesus Christ the life. And no man comes unto the Father except through Him. But on the other side, a divided church gives the sinner an excuse. And I don't want to give the sinner another excuse. The last place that should give the sinner any excuse to remain outside of the blood of Jesus is the body of Christ. Lord, forgive us. Lord, forgive us for giving the lost an excuse to stay lost. Amen? You see, our pettiness causes the lost to go to hell. You say that's hard. I say that's real. Lord, have mercy on us. May a spirit of repentance fall upon the body of Christ. In the name of Jesus. That we might turn to God again. That we might return to God. I notice in the scriptures that God always calls his people first. To return to the Lord. And we've got a divine mandate to return to the God who purchased us through his Son. For God so loved the world. He purchased us with his own blood. Oh Lord, have mercy on us. Unity. I love to read the book of Acts. Do you? I want to live it. Anybody else? I don't just want to read it. I want to live it. But one thing I notice about Acts is that the early believers were unified. And there was power in their unity. They met. Acts 1:14 tells us that they were in one accord. They were in agreement with one another. But their agreement, I want you to pay attention here, was not based upon an agreement with each other. Somebody hear this. Their agreement was on what God had spoken. Listen to this. This is the key to genuine unity. The source of our agreement is based upon what God has spoken, not what man thinks.
Amen.
The source of our agreement is upon what God has spoken, not what man thinks.
Amen.
Amos chapter 3, verse 3 reads this. Can two walk together unless they're agreed? Pastor Harrigan, can I bother you for a minute, sir? I'd like to walk over there with you. Would you like to join me, please? See, if Pastor Harrigan had not agreed with me, he could not walk with me.
Amen.
And if I need to understand how this works here, see, God is the one who's on the journey. And he invites. Enjoy. God is going this way. Are you hearing this, church? Are you hearing this? Are you hearing this? You see, the problem, the reason why we're so divided is because we're trying to get unity on this level first. You follow me? See, I'm an Assemblies of God minister, okay? And we have this thing called the 16 fundamental truths. That sounds kind of impressive, doesn't it? How many does your church have? 27! I guess I'm going to have to file a petition to get 28. But anyway, that's beside the point. We'll deal with that later. As of right now, we got 16 fundamental truths, and they are what we as a denomination believe. And we've got, and we even narrow it down more to four cardinal doctrines. Christ the Savior, Christ the Baptizer and the Holy Ghost and fire, Christ the Healer, and Christ the soon coming King, and I believe all four of them. With all of my heart. But you know what? If I were to bring my document and line it up with your church's documents, I think we'd find some differences. What do you think? We could hammer it out all night, trying to come up with. The problem is that if we were to come up with a unified doctrine, we would all have to compromise. The problem is that that compromise would mean I would have to give up something that actually means a lot to me.
Go ahead.
And you would have to give up a lot that means to you. And the bottom line is this. Even if we could hammer out this document, we couldn't stay unified for very long. And I want to tell you why. It's because we all change our mind.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Anybody willing to admit you're a little fickle? Even men can admit to this. They've put a shirt on and taken it off and put it back in the closet. Now, ladies, they change 5 dresses. Men, we only change 1. Usually once every 3 or 4 days we should change it. You know what I'm saying, man? The root of our division is looking for a natural agreement at the expense of a supernatural agreement. So in other words, I want to challenge us to stop trying to agree this way. Because it doesn't work. So let's quit. I'm going to look at Scripture a little bit different than you, but I'm going to trust in the blood. Somebody, get this in your spirit tonight. It's the blood of Jesus that matters. And nothing else really matters. I want my sin washed. I want to be washed in the blood. Washed in the blood. Washed in the blood. And if I'm washed in the blood, and so are you, we are now related. Somebody, praise the Lord. The source of our unity will never be a spoken agreement. The source of our unity will never be a document of perfect union. The source of our unity will only and forever be the Word of God. Because my opinion changes, but the Word of the Lord endures forever. This is the key to unity, church. So we need to repent. Lord, forgive us. Forgive us for trying to form agreement with man without basing it on agreement with God. This is the key to unity. You see, you can't have unity. You can't have unity at all. If you do it, well, based upon a personal agreement. Would you like to join me walking over there? Would you like to join me walking over there? Sir, would you like to join me, please? Come join me, please, for a minute. Yes, come join me, ma'am. Would you come join me, please? Excuse me, ma'am. Would you come join me, please? We're going to walk over here. We're going to walk over here. Just come join me, please, for a moment. Come join me, please. You see, we're all walking differently, aren't we? But we're all going to the same place. Amen? You can go ahead. You can go ahead and be seated. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Are you seeing what I'm saying here? We got to stop trying to get everybody to walk like us. We got to stop trying to get everybody to talk like us. We got to stop even trying to get everybody to read the same version of the Bible or sing the same songs. And we got to learn to depend upon the blood. Are you going to the same place that I'm going? Giving my life to Jesus Christ. I'm going to spend my eternity with Jesus, so you might as well get used to me now. Hallelujah. Have you given your life to Jesus? Now, are you under the blood? Then maybe you're going to walk a little bit different than me. Some people might walk like this. Some people are more cool, like me. But if we're all going to walk, let's walk in faith in the one who loved me and died. This is our key to unity. If we don't get this, we won't get the second key. And I emphasize this. If we keep trying to agree here, we're never going to get it.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord. You see, our unity will be formed based upon the promise of God.
Amen.
And nothing else. Acts chapter 4, verse 32 describes the believers this way, as of one heart and soul. Natural unity cannot create of one heart and soul. Only a supernatural agreement can. All right, praise the Lord. I'll try not to put you to sleep. So I'll try to wrap it up. Now, when I was in Bible college, one thing I learned is that a preacher gets 7 in conclusions. So when I start saying in conclusion, you just start counting. 1. 2. Y'all with me?
Yeah.
Church, our unity will only be powerful and lasting if our unity is what based on what God has spoken. Because the word of the Lord will endure forever. That's the key to unity. The second key is simply this: the love of God. Now please notice that I did not say the love of each other. I said the love of God. Because true unity is a supernatural thing. If you don't believe me, put 2 toddlers in a room with 1 toy. Y'all know what's going to happen. You are going to see original sin in full display. Amen? Tell me we're all fundamentally good. No, we're not, because one of them's got the fire engine going bonk, bonk, bonk on the other. It takes a supernatural love to glue us together. And divine love is the glue that keeps us stuck together. So our agreement is with God. And then we're all walking the same place, so we're already in agreement. Secondly, it's this divine love. It's the same love that motivated God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
That is not natural love. That is supernatural love. It is the love of God that motivated him to send Jesus that has been shine abroad in our hearts. When we come to faith in Jesus Christ, that very same love becomes manifest in our hearts. Hallelujah. What manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, 1 John reads, that we should be called children of God. See, when I was a young man, I was a musician. And I looked a little bit different in those days. I was a long-haired electric guitar player. Played hard rock, played lead guitar for hard rock bands. Thought I was going to be the next Eddie Van Halen. And then I found Jesus. I was on the highway to hell. But God lifted me up. I was an angry, bitter young man. But then I met love. Hallelujah. What about you? Have you met love? 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 through 11, read this: Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifest toward us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation, a big fancy word that means Jesus paid it all.
Hallelujah.
To pay for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, let us love one another. In other words, because God loved me, I can love you. Because God loved you, you can love me. If God didn't love me, I couldn't love you, even though you're amazing. It's just the way it is. You see, this whole thing is supernatural. There's no natural about it at all. And we've made a mistake in the body of Christ, is we've become way too natural. We're dependent upon ourselves. We're dependent upon our talents. We're dependent upon our money. We're dependent upon our resources. We're dependent. We're dependent upon our smarts. And so we think we're so smart that we can work something out with ourselves, and we can somehow work something. Look, it's never going to work. It comes from God. It doesn't come from man. Let me just have a Pentecostal moment. Are you with me? It is not by might. It is not by power. Somebody, but by we become in the natural. It's not by our mind. I don't care how smart we get, how sophisticated we get, how educated we get, how connected we get. It is not by power. It will always be and has forever been by the Spirit of God Almighty. And if we keep the Spirit of God out of the church, we've got nothing left. He said, wait for the promise of the Father. He said, wait for it. That means pray. That means believe. That means seek after. And I don't care how you interpret the Holy Ghost, you need the Holy Ghost. You need the Holy Ghost to fire in this generation. God's calling a generation to rise up again. We don't have to say the first generation had it all. Why not the last? We are living in the last days. We are seeing love get cold. We are seeing hearts get hard. And there's only one thing that's going to melt, and that's the fire of the Holy Ghost. That is the Spirit of the living God. Praise you, Jesus. Oh, it's not by us, it's by Him. It will never be by us. It will always be by Him. It will never be by my ability to speak, or your ability to sing, or your ability to dance, or your ability to play a musical instrument. It will only and forever be by the Spirit of the living God. And He can still turn this generation upside down. I remember when Paul went to a certain city, and they came up after him, and they said, the men who have turned the world upside down have come here too. Is it not time for St. Croix to get turned upside down? Is it not time for the Church of Jesus Christ to arise on this island? And once again, be a unified body, understanding that we're all walking with God, and so we're all walking together. In the name of Jesus. Let the real church arise in the power of Jesus Christ. I said, let the real church arise. The real church is a unified church. The real church is a powerful church. The real church is an overcoming church. And if you're under the blood of Jesus, you're a part of that church. You don't have to be defeated anymore. You don't have to be beat down anymore. You have the Holy Ghost living in you. You have the Spirit of the living God dwelling within you. Church of Jesus Christ, arise in the name of Jesus and take your rightful place on this island. You don't have to be beat anymore. You are an overcoming one. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You see, it's not natural. Unity is not natural. Let me give you one more example. In conclusion, number two. Let me give you a little example. Politics. How many of you love politics? I hate politics. Just don't like it. You know why? Because they're fighting all the time. And they're lying all the time. We've got good governors and we've got bad governors. We've got good senators and we've got bad senators. You know what? Actually, I really do. I praise God for government. I just don't want to be a part of it. You know what I'm saying? Because if we didn't have government, we'd have chaos. And through what we've all been through, I praise God that there's government. And I do. I hope we're praying for the folks. Because, you know, people will come to me and say, Pastor, I don't want your job. I look at the governor and say, man, I definitely don't want your job. Amen? And so if we're going to vote somebody else to do it, we better get behind them in prayer. We better hold them up. Otherwise, it might come calling to you. Amen? But look, in the political scene, we've got a lot of infighting, right? We keep calling for unity, and it seems like the more we call for unity, the more we fight with each other. It's just not natural. It's supernatural. So I want to leave you with this one last thought. That's number three, by the way. First key to supernatural unity is we agree with God and we go God's direction. Together. And as we're walking that way, you and I are all together going that way. We all walk differently, we sing different songs, we do our thing differently. Doesn't matter, we're under the blood, glory to God, we're going to heaven. And God puts a heart of love in us, the same heart that sent Jesus to die for each one of us. That's in you right now, church. That love's in you. It's all supernatural. And so, this is the real one. You're not as divided as you think you are if you look in the right place. If you look to your agreement with God rather than each other, you're going to find you're a whole lot more united than you thought you were. And you're going to rise up in the power of the Holy Ghost. You're going to turn this island upside down in Jesus' name.
Amen. Hallelujah.